Praise be to God this morning for our wonderful intro here we have this morning. Praise be to God and welcome to each and one of you here on this wonderful morning, friends. I am the Reverend Dr. Jeffrey Cooper, and it's my joy and pleasure to welcome each and every one of you here on this 17th Sunday after Pentecost here on this worldwide communion Sunday. Friends, it's a day which we celebrate that God invites all to the table, all across the nation, all those who would call on his name, invited to that table. And so we give God thanks this morning, friends. We give God thanks and praise for this wonderful word and service we have for us here this morning. Friends, I want to give God thanks today. Lift up our team here today, our director of music, our brother Kenneth, our liturgist and reader, our leader, our brother Earl. And we give God thanks this morning, friends, for our choir who joins us to lend their voice and sing this day. Friends, I have a few announcements to make and share with you. Again, these messages do go out to you in your church life. If you're sitting there wondering what church life is, won't you give us an email, send an email to the back of the bulletins, and you can send an email down there to the church. We'll be happy to get that to you. But it is our weekly newsletter that comes out each and every week with a small thought from me, but also, friends, has a calendar of all the events and things that are going on here in the life of our church, and we'd love to have you be a part of that. So I will highlight a few of them, friends, but I don't highlight all of them. So please do read your church life, as we'd love to have you be a part of all the good things that we're doing here at church. Friends, hospitality, they're looking for volunteers to assist during coffee hour. There is a sign-up sheet in the Bird Calibre room. I did take a look. A couple have signed up, so thanks to God for those who have signed up. But friends, we're still looking for others. So if you'd like to sign up, individuals, families, or committees can sign. You can call the church office, and our sister Arlene will happily add you on to our list. Also, friends, we're thankful to be headed back to church in person. As we're here in person, as we came into the narthex, we see that, friends, there is a box that is for a food collection that we take here on Sunday mornings. And we're doing so, friends, to help with the great food need for many here in our community who find themselves going on a day-to-day not knowing where their next meal will come from. And yet to think that in such a small way, we can help out. So, friends, we support the various food pantries here. We can contact our sister Marianne to help bring food delivered. Friends, offering envelopes are available in the narthex, so please take an offering envelope, and please make sure two things are in there for us, is to fill out your name and your envelope number. And if you don't know what your envelope number is, you can contact Sister Eileen, and she'll be happy to get that to you. Friends, also we have hearing aids available, so if there are somebody whose hearing is a difficulty or a challenge, you can see our ushers. We'd love to get a hearing aid to you. Our choir rules, friends, those of us who are foreign members of the choir, or perhaps maybe have a choir rule at home, the choir is, we're running short on robes, so if you do have a choir, a robe at home, and you're not near, please do bring those back and be so grateful to you. And also, friends, as you know, for our brothers and sisters in the state of Florida who are going through so much difficulty right now, friends, the conference has let us know the best way to support right now is through prayer and donations, not to self-employ. Any opportunities to volunteer will be coordinated by the affected conferences and typically involve training first. To make a monetary donation, you can do so to UNCOR, U.S. Disaster Response, advance number 91670. Once more, that is UNCOR, U.S. Disaster Response, and the advance number is 901670. And again, it is an opportunity, friends, to give financially. Again, the information has been sent out in your church life, so if you didn't hear that, please read your church life, because that is in there for you. And last, but certainly not least, friends, our Grace Methodist Nursery School still continues to look for a mommy and a teacher and other substitutes. So if you know someone who can fit that, won't you let them know and contact our sister Diane? We'd love to have you be part of what they're doing. And friends, our final announcement today is, does it seem brighter in here? That's an actual question.
Yes.
It looks brighter in here, don't it?
Yes.
When you look around, right, it's like the light, you look down over here, the call is bright down here, friends, here in the 8th century, the lights are brighter. Well, we're going to give God thanks to our trustee board, and I want to thank our brother Earl and our brother Bob, who came down here, friends, and they installed these new LED lights. So let's give God thanks. Yes, friends, and I promise you, when I walked in this morning, Sister Lisa and I had this moment of like, we thought it was too dark outside, so it was so bright in here. And then we realized, wow, look at that, friends. So praise to God for these lights, and again, it may seem like something simple, like changing light bulbs, friends, but it's a small example of saying this. A small example where we say, Lord, here I am, God, use me. You may not be able to preach a sermon, friends, but if you can screw in a light bulb, if you can hold a ladder, there is a place for you. And so, praise be to God, and we thank God this morning for our trustees and the wonderful care they continue to show and share here for our sanctuary. All right, friends, with all that said and shared, I'm going to turn over to our leader.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Please join me in opening 374, standing on the cross.
Lord,
round the world today.
Christians are here.
Stanton.
Good morning.
Good morning, Church.
Good morning.
On behalf of, on behalf of Grace Methodist Nursery School, as you may know, Grace Methodist Nursery School is a tremendous family. Every child and their family joins the nursery school family when they attend Grace Methodist Nursery School. That is 51 years of family members. I'm very proud today to say that so many of our family members have dedicated themselves professionally to serving the community as doctors, lawyers, dentists, firefighters, police officers, teachers, nurses, and members of the military. The list goes on and on. Today, I'm here to speak about two very special young ladies. One of them is a Grace Methodist Nursery School alumni. Caitlin and Isabella are seniors Girl Scouts troop 2259 from Dallas Union. As scouts, they chose to work towards earning a silver award. To earn a silver award, these young ladies had to identify an issue in the community, explore the community and pick a project, develop that project, put a plan in motion, and share their story and celebrate. After visiting Grace Methodist Nursery School, Caitlin and Elizabeth became aware and concerned about the effects that COVID had on the socialization skills of young children. In early childhood, most of the socialization takes place in play. Caitlin and Elizabeth chose the Grace Methodist Nursery School playground as the Silver Award project. Their goal was to refresh and enhance the playground so that it would be a clean and safe area for socialization through play. To achieve this goal, the girls, under their supervision of their leaders, Jordan and Christine, sold lemonade in order to raise funds to purchase a much needed user-friendly sandbox cover so that the sandbox, a very popular play area for the children, could be once again used. In addition, they power washed the outdoor equipment, sanded and painted the bench, and added protective outdoor carpet onto the cement windowsills and protrude into the playground area. Their research and story is shared in a brochure they created about the importance of play. The copies of the brochure are located on the table at the back that you can pick up on your way out. Today, we complete the final phase of this Silver Award process by celebrating Caitlin and Isabella. Thank you, Caitlin and Isabella, for choosing the Christmas Nursery School Playground as your Silver Award project. The children, the faculty of the group, and the whole entire Grace Methodist family, as well as Grace United Methodist Church, thank you proudly for your incredible effort and outstanding results. I invite our Caitlin and Isabella to join me up here. While we're coming up, I would just like to the members of my staff that were able to attend today to please also stand up. Thank you to you.
Stewardship and what it is and what it means. So this morning, when I think about stewardship, when I think about all that God has done for me, friends, it reminds me that to the very core of the message of stewardship, one truth remains. The saying is that I am loved by God, that you are loved by God. Friends, during the time of stewardship, forget everything else I want to say during these next 3 weeks. Please, oh please, hear this and don't forget it. Never, never forget the basis upon which, friends, our hearts are spread, that I love God and you are loved by God. There is a place in God's heart that only you can fill. A place that only I could fill. Truly, this is the bottom line of our spiritual journey. This exploration of, this responding to the extravagant heart of God. That heart that loves, that heart that so freely gives and cares for us. You see, the Bible makes it unmistakably clear that God loves each of us as though we were the only person in the world. And yet we know that God gives a dedication on all of God's people. So friends, during these next 3 weeks, we will think about the ways which we are responding to God's extravagant hearts. We will wrap ourselves in the robe of grace, undeserved forgiveness, unconditional favor, unmerited friendship, and unbelievable freedom. Hear me, all of us can experience this, the extravagant heart of God, as we consider our stewardship of our time, our talents, and our resources. Friends, now is the time to start fresh. Now is our time to start anew, to look ahead and to be expecting that God is going to accomplish great things here at our church. So I do hope, friends, when you have a moment, you'll take the time to read that little gold sheet, and you'll have a moment to have some conversation as we see each other. Perhaps just something to think about. But friends, as we begin to think about the extravagant part of God, the ways in which we express it, and how we share our love our Lord. Amen? So, once you take them home with you, give it a read. And friends, I do hope you'll enjoy with us. And over these next couple of weeks, as we talk about our stewardship campaign, when the time comes, friends, that together we will joyfully commit to the Lord. Let's continue. Father,
amen. The scripture reading is taken from the New Testament, 2 Timothy, verse 1 from 1 to 14. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, for the sake of promise of life that in Christ Jesus, Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus, our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did when I remembered him constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure it lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of coins, but rather a spirit of power and love and out of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed then of the testimony of our Lord or of me, his prisoner, the joy that we have suffered for the gospel, relying on the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and the grace This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages of heaven. But it has not been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to life through gospel. For this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. And for this reason I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he will be able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. How the standard sounds, teaching that you have heard from me, faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasures entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. The word of God for the people of God.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, my brother Earl, for reading the Lord. This text, and friends, I'm going to ask to stand as we came to hear the gospel lesson. Our gospel lesson this day comes from the writings of St. Luke. This is from the 17th chapter, verses 5 through 10. Once more, friends, this is the gospel according to St. Luke. This is the 17th chapter, verses 5 through 10. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." He replied, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it will obey you. Suppose one of you has a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Will he say to the other servant when he comes into the field, 'Come along now and sit down and eat'? Won't he rather say, 'Prepare my supper, get yourself ready, and wait on me while I eat and drink? After that, you may eat and drink.' Will he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you have done everything you were told to do, should say, 'We are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty.'" This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen. Amen. So we're going to invite us out before we get to our message this morning to turn our hymnals to hymn number 452, number 452. My faith looks up to thee. My faith looks up to thee.
Thank you.
By affirming his call as an apostle and also as a teacher. They differ enough in language and content from Paul's seven undisputed letters, which is Romans, 1 and 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Philippians, 1 Thessalonians, and Philemon. Those seven letters, scholarly say, absolutely, Paul is 100% asking the writer of those letters. So they suggest to us that either an author who may have been a follower of Paul, maybe one who was present during his 5 days or with him incarcerated, or one from a generation later, responds to the church conflict by invoking Paul's authority. But regardless, friends, what we do know is the author intends to communicate to church leaders a call to remain faithful to the very tradition that they have received from the Apostle Paul and to demonstrate a faith by making sure to pass it on. You see, Paul calls upon Timothy to carry on his legacy, urging him as a leader in the church to rekindle his faith by trusting and relying on the spiritual heritage that someone had gifted to him, that Timothy had received from his biological family, from his mother and his grandmother, and also by that which he had received from his family of faith, including Paul himself. You see, when we read our text from verse 6 on, there's almost a tone of urgency. We hear to Paul stressing the importance of his work. We know by our readings, friends, that Paul has a mission to complete. And there would be nothing that would deter him, nothing would stop him. Determined to his mission, not even the end of his life could stop him if he could figure out a way. So Timothy and the church were not to keep this truth, not to hide this thing away, but Paul was telling them, Paul was reminding them, as he reminds us here this morning, that we are all invited not to keep, but friends were called to share our good treasure. A little boy was walking down the beach, and he's walking down to take a look at the people, and he happens to come by an elderly woman who's sitting in the sand by herself. He walked up to her and said, "Excuse me, are you a Christian?" And she says, "Yes." "Do you read your Bible every day?" And she says, "Yes." "Do you read, pray often?" And again, she responded with yes. And with that, the little boy said, "Okay, I have one final question. Will you hold my yo-yo while I go swimming?" You see, friends, the small boy understood the importance of his treasure. He understood it was so valuable that he needed to make sure he was keeping it in the right place. He could not just leave his treasure just anywhere. I wonder where it is we have kept our good treasure. Have we buried all on a remote deserted island with a secret map that only we know where to find it? Has life put us in a position, friends, we have felt that our backs are against the wall, that we felt that our faith can only go as far as the tip of our nose? You ever heard that faith only goes as far as the tip of your nose? By the silence, I'm getting up. Then, friends, faith that goes as far as the tip of your nose is faith that only is concerned about me. And my faith stops right here. Goes no further, goes no far back. It ends and starts with me. Friends, Paul would tell us that trials and tribulations tend to be the pair, tend to be the twins that keep us from feeling like we have all to offer. Trials and tribulations tend to make us feel as though we've got nothing. We find ourselves in a place where we say, "Lord, I have nothing to give. God, I have nothing to share. None in my heart, none to give." We think about all the times that we try, all the times we said, "Yes, Lord," and we failed. All the times we said, "Yes, Lord," and things did not turn out for the best. You see, writing from a Roman prison from which he doesn't expect to be released from, Paul feels the same way. Paul had this feeling, thinking about his life and all that he had done. He shares with Timothy. He lets him know there's going to be some bad days. Friends, do you know that? We're going to have some rough days. Are you aware? Friends, there'll be some moments when things will not go well, but where the twins of trial and tribulation, they'll know you by first name. They'll know you by first name. They'll do their best to keep you pressed on back. You see, living in that situation, Paul would not be deterred despite the situation. good fortune. You see, even Paul experienced his fair share of troubles. Even Paul in his work as a disciple had setbacks in place where things didn't go the way they were. Paul experienced, he had followers who deserted him. His awareness that there's an ongoing conflict with the larger Christian community, with Gentiles and with those who believe. His knowledge of people were turning away from the faith, setback after setback, and yet despite such heartbreak, despite such difficulty, Paul's faith would not be shaken. Paul's faith would not be turned down. Paul's faith would not be turned away, even here in the face of impending death. Paul understood the importance of his good treasure and the absolute need to share it. Church, hear me. We all have good treasure, just like the Apostle Paul. All of us have time. We have times. We have resources. God is calling us to share. It is calling us to share. We must have the faith in doing these good works. Friends, if you tried in the past and you tried to share what God has given to you and it didn't go right, try again. And if you feel that God has let you down, that things didn't turn out the way you like, hear the Apostle Paul this morning call out to you, share your good treasure, try again. Friends, all of us know the heart and love of God. It's why we're here this morning. We've experienced it in some way, in some form, in some fashion. This morning, God woke us up in our right mind and saw us on our way. So, friends, I know I can stand here this morning and talk about that love and see there are people who know that love I'm talking about. But, friends, like good treasure, let us not bury that love in a box somewhere on the dirt. Now, don't put it in a shoebox under your bed, but, friends, dare to have this good treasure and share it. Dare to give this good treasure and share it with somebody else. Friends, not allow it to be a light that goes dim, but a light that burns bright. A light, friends, that we've got to feed. We've got to feed it. Feed it with words. Feed it with our actions, friends. Feed it with our faith. You and I, people, call to share the good treasure that God gives us, that you and I are called to share with somebody else. On a cold February day, a snail started climbing up an apple tree. As he inched slowly upward, a worm stuck its head out from the crevice in between the bark to offer some words of advice. "You know," the worm says, "you know you're wasting your time. There isn't a single apple up there." Well, without breaking stride or even bothering to turn his head, the snail responds, "They aren't there now, but I know they will be there when I get there." There are many of us that have had a conversation just like that at some point of our faith journey. Someone came along the way and said to you, "Why are you still trying? Don't you know it's not going to work? Just give up. Don't you know people don't want to go to church on Sunday mornings? People aren't interested, just give up. People are too busy, they've got other things to do." And yet here we are this morning. I'm here to remind you that all of us have good treasure. We all have faith, we all have time, we all have talents and resources that God is calling us to share. But friends, not just to share for us, but friends calling to share with somebody else. And we all know that voice. We all know that voice that sits in the back of our mind and says, "Nah, don't worry about it. You won't make a difference. Someone else will take care of it. You, it doesn't matter." Friends, hear me. This is one of the biggest traps our faith falls for. You matter. As I said this morning during our stewardship moment, God loves you as though you're the only person in the world. And yet, friends, each and every one of us experience and share in that love of God. So as the Apostle Paul reminds us, with our faith, with our time, and with our talents, friends, let us not look to bury it, not look to hide, not look to keep it for ourselves, but to be so bold that we would share our good treasure. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so this morning, friends, we've all been there. And if you haven't, I assure you, you may find yourself in a place where your faith says to you, try again. Trust me. And yet your wisdom, your experience has said, but I tried, Lord. I tried and it never works out for me. I tried to share my faith, but it just doesn't work. I invited people to church and they don't come back. I tried and I tried. And here this morning, friends, we share our message. Once more, I want to invite you that, friends, if you tried and you tried and you failed, that this morning you would dare to give God another chance. That this morning, friends, you would dare to give faith another opportunity. Friends, this morning, you would make yourself available. That you would say, yes, Lord, here I am. God, as your people, we know, Lord, that God, as we can touch our hands and our feet, friends, and we know that you and I are truly the hands and feet of Jesus Christ. So, friends, let us not work by ourselves, but truly, let us seek to work together. Together as a church, but together with God. And so this morning, as we share our word, Pastor Trevor, and invite you to get to our altar. That, friends, who goes into trial and we fail, and perhaps this morning you're here and say, Pastor, I'm going to try. I would invite you this morning that God reinforce our faith again. And once more, friends, that we would be the people that say, yes, Lord, we've got this good treasure. Help me find a way to share. So when we come to our altar this morning, friends, let us share a word of prayer today. And so, friends, hear now these words of invitation. Christ, our Lord, invites to his table all who love him and earnestly repent of their sin, seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let's confess our sin before God and one another. I'd like to pray this prayer with me. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard our cry to you. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear now, friends, the words of assurance. Hear this good news. Christ died for us all while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God.
Amen. Amen, church. Pastor says, try again. Try Jesus. Whenever you gave, try Jesus. And as we're here to pass the peace this morning, why don't we give peace a chance? Moments of brothers and sisters. Songwriter says, on your saved, give peace a chance. So, passing on the peace. The light of Christ is upon us. Turn and greet one another with the peace of Christ, allowing Christ's light to shine among us. Let the peace that surpasses all understanding be with us today. Peace.
Thank you.
know. We give everything. Father God, we thank you for this guiding wall. And Father God, we thank you for turning our insufficiency into life. We thank you for the abundance that you promised us. We don't, Father God, truly move everything is possible. From the big to something, from the big to small. From the rising of the sun to the going down below, you give us the gift of eternal life. So as we give this offering to you this day, Father God, we thank you. And we thank you for your abundance to come. In your name we pray.
Let us pray these words together. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. Friends, as we remain standing, our closing hymn this morning is hymn number 714, number 714, I Know Whom I Have Believed.
Thank you.
So as God has poured God's love on you, go now in peace to bring God's love to all people. Rest in the confidence of God's abiding presence with you and be joyful in your service to God. Go in peace and love to share